Where is my beloved land? Who snatched its happiness? Who destroyed its beauty? Who burned its charm? Where is my Kashmir? Where is my beloved land? Respected judges, honorable chief guests, teachers, and my dear fellow friends, Assalamu alaikum. I am Atiya Ijaz, and topic of my speech today is human rights violations in Indian occupied Kashmir and role of international community. Human rights, whatever is the definition of human rights, is exactly what has not been happening in Indian occupied Kashmir since 70 years now. All their rights are breached and fractured. Our brothers, our sisters, our mothers are treated brutally every other day. Human rights violations in Kashmir are systematic, deliberate, and officially sanctioned. In Kashmir, poorly trained military troops are treating civilians by extrajudicial killings, murders, and rapes, which is leading to spread of lawless state terrorism. It's surprising India still calls itself to be the world's largest democracy. Information combined by various human rights organizations like London-based Amnesty International, New York-based Asia Watch, and other humanitarian organizations establishes that a massive grumble of brutal oppression has been launched by the Indian Army since January 1990. The misuse of pellet guns by the Indian Army has caused numerous casualties, and ample of our people are visually impaired now. The UN is still not taking any action on it. It's been 27 years since the Konan Pushpura mass rape. Women in two villages of Kupwara ask, when will the questions end and the answers begin? The glimpse of this horrendous February night of 1991 gives me goosebumps and clenches my heart with grief. These attacks by state forces are against the Geneva Convention of 1949 and the two additional protocols of 1977. Terrorist and Disruptive Activities Prevention Act, commonly known as TARA, was the first anti-terrorism law forced by the Indian Parliament between 1985 and 1995. Act's third paragraph clearly mentioned the use of weapons or poisonous gases or anything that affects the harmony amongst different sections of the people will be considered as an act of terrorism. Well, sir, we all know what Indian Army is using and what not. Furthermore, Jammu and Kashmir also tops list on human rights abuses under Armed Forces Special Powers Act. In 1948, UN for the first time intervened in the matter. The UN formed a five-member commission made up of Argentina, Colombia, Belgium, Czechoslovakia, and the United States. They drew up a resolution calling for a referendum to decide Kashmir's future. The resolution also included ceasefire from both parties and a truce agreement, which meant that the state of Jammu and Kashmir will be demilitarized. In March 1949, UNCIP convened a meeting at the representatives of the two parties, at which they were invited to present the discussions of proposals for the implementation of demilitarization. Pakistan compiled and suggested a framework within which the high command of the two armies could work out together for the withdrawal program. However, India did not submit any plan for the joint discussion and agreement. United Nations stayed silent on the matter. India kept showing stubbornness to the various peacemaking activities forwarded by the United Nations. In 1957, a Swedish diplomat, Mr. Jarring, made notable efforts by visiting both Pakistan and India. He reported that both governments declared that they were held together by UNCIP resolutions. Holding a free and impartial plebiscite to decide the question of accession of the state to India or Pakistan under UN's auspices. However, like previous attempts, Dr. Jarring also failed to solve the problem due to the uncooperative attitude of India. To conclude, the resolution of Kashmir dispute is vital for the peace in this region. Kashmiri people were and are still denied of their basic human rights. for the preservation and promotion of which UN had come into existence. Though primarily as a territorial dispute between India and Pakistan, it also concerns the people themselves who should be ensured of their fundamental rights. If UN could send a coalition force against the North Korean communists in the Korean War, then why, Mr. President, why? Why it cannot use force or impose sanctions to ensure compliance with its resolutions? United Nations must restore its prestige as a champion of human rights by giving proper attention to Kashmir issue and by providing them with the right to exercise freedom of expression and self-determination. But this one another thing. Why are we whining about UN's resolution? What are we doing about it? Being a youth of Kashmir, are we using our power for freedom? Why are we not using our power for freedom? Why not make our own united youth? Let's start from our social media by using the hashtag Kashmir Matters. Tell me, will you contribute with me? Will you contribute with me? Will you stand for the freedom? Will you fight for yourselves? This is not what we want, people. We want more spirit. We want the spirit so that we could free our people. Tell me, will you stand with me?
Yes.
Will you stand for the freedom?
Yes.
This is the spirit. This is the spirit which will free our land and give us our identities. We will take what is ours, and no power can stop us. Thank you so much.